When you think of a science lab, you might think of something that looks like this. Studying something that looks like these. Well, most scientists do indeed study mice. Mice are model organisms for human research because, one, mice are easy to reproduce and study in a lab space, and two, mice are mammals, warm-blooded, hair-growing animals like ourselves. We can learn about our biology by studying other mammals. Scientists therefore tend to use mice to answer human health questions. In fact, the National Association of Biomedical Research, and speaking of research, estimated in 2015 and 2019 that approximately 95% of all warm-blooded US laboratory animals are mice and rats. Unsurprisingly, more is known about mouse biology than any other animal, except maybe for humans. But just because mice are model organisms, does that then mean that mice are always the best organisms to answer human health questions? People around the world eat too much sugar. If your body is constantly exposed to high sugar levels, then this can result in type 2 diabetes. When we eat sugar, our pancreas produces a hormone called insulin, and its job is to help remove sugar from the bloodstream by unlocking cell doors. Type 2 diabetes is a chronic disease that occurs when either your pancreas doesn't produce enough insulin or your cells stop responding to insulin properly, resulting in an inability to remove sugar from the bloodstream. According to the World Health Organization, diabetes became the 8th leading cause of death in 2021. Diabetes is also one of the most expensive chronic conditions in the world. In 2022, the US spent 1 out of every 4 healthcare dollars on direct and indirect medical costs related to diabetes. Even more alarming, diagnoses are only projected to increase, as currently 1 in 3 American adults have prediabetes. So, what can we do to treat this growing diabetic population? Well, the easiest approach to therapeutics and the approach that most scientists take is study the mouse. But outside of the laboratory filled with mice, there are mammals that love sugar, like ourselves, but don't suffer from diabetes. I'm talking about fruit bats. Now, if you have chiroptophobia, the fear of bats, I'm gonna ask you to shed that fear just for the next few minutes and put on a lab coat. Now, fruit bats can eat up to twice their body weights a day in sugary fruit, yet they can lower that blood sugar faster than other bats and any other mammal. Determining how fruit bats evolved to specialize on a high sugar diet sent me and my colleagues on a quest to approach diabetes therapy from an unconventional angle. Approximately 2% of our DNA is composed of genes, which are segments of DNA that contain the instructions cells use to create our traits, like the color of our eyes. The other 98% of our DNA includes regulatory DNA, which are segments of DNA that control genes by turning them on or off. This system operates much like a traffic light, tells you to go, slow down, or stop. Regulatory DNA is the reason that approximately 45% of you in this room have brown eyes, and around 27% of you in this room have blue eyes. To understand how fruit bats evolved to consume so much sugar, we wanted to identify the DNA and cell differences between bats that eat fruit and bats that eat insects, which have the ancestral diet. In our recently published research, we applied a new technology that analyzes individual cells to compare the Jamaican fruit bat to the insect-eating big brown bat. Specifically, we looked for the genes, regulatory DNA, and cell types across two significant metabolic organs, the pancreas and the kidney. Now, I'd love to tell you about the kidney, but I'm going to save that investigation for your own time following this talk. The pancreas produces the hormone insulin to help us lower our blood sugar, but it also produces the hormone glucagon to help us raise our blood sugar. We first applied our new technology to detect pancreas cell types, and we counted more insulin-producing cells in our Jamaican fruit bats, as well as more glucagon-producing cells in our Jamaican fruit bats. Of course, we can't get too excited because we have to verify these results under a microscope. And indeed, we observed more insulin-producing cells, depicted in red here, in our Jamaican fruit bats, as well as more glucagon-producing cells, also depicted in red here, in our Jamaican fruit bats compared to our insect-eating big brown bats. Analyzing their DNA, we discovered that Jamaican fruit bats have unique regulatory DNA for the insulin gene. This green mountain of data you see in front of the fruit bat insulin gene indicates that Jamaican fruit bats are turning on that insulin gene and creating lots and lots of insulin, more than our big brown bats, which is indeed what we observed. We also discovered that Jamaican fruit bats have unique regulatory DNA for the glucagon gene. This other mountain of data in front of the fruit bat glucagon gene again indicates that Jamaican fruit bats are turning on that glucagon gene and creating lots and lots of glucagon. For the first time, we unveiled regulatory DNA evidence for how fruit bats may be regulating their blood sugar levels on a high sugar diet. The increased presence of insulin-producing and glucagon-producing cells, combined with the unique regulatory DNA in front of the insulin and glucagon genes, likely allows for greater production of blood sugar hormones in fruit bats. Our research provides novel insight into the evolution of a mammal that, unlike humans and mice, actually thrives off of sugar. Figuring out how fruit bats can handle high sugar loads allows us to identify unique therapeutic targets for diabetes, like this regulatory DNA. By applying new technologies on non-model organisms, organisms researchers don't conventionally use, we are among a growing group of researchers who show that the non-models have a lot to teach us. In fact, we wouldn't have the diabetes drug Ozempic if it wasn't for studying the non-model organism, the Gila monster. Who knew that the only venomous lizard native to the United States developed one of the most successful diabetes medications in its venom 8,000 years ago? The Gila monster, described as frightful and repulsive. Bats, described as disease carriers, bloodsuckers, agricultural pests. We need to recognize that conventional norms may be keeping us from learning valuable insights. Whether we're talking about model organisms, model cars, theoretical models, it's important to ask ourselves, is this model really the best to address the issue at hand? As a biologist, what might I find by stepping away from the model and looking at the world around me? As an entrepreneur, a financial analyst, a psychologist, what might you discover when you find your non-model? Thank you.